In America, we consume billions of drugs. Valium to ease stress, alcohol to relieve tension, coffee to get us moving. Not to mention the use and abuse of a myriad of other drugs, both legal and illegal. Why is it that we consume such an abundance of agents to alter consciousness? Perhaps it's because we want to alter our consciousness in order to rise above the mediocre and the mundane in our life. Or we may wish to escape what we perceive as the pain of life. What if there were other ways, far superior to drugs, that opened us up to the highest part of ourselves? For untold eons, sages and mystics have intimated there are other realities we are missing or simply not seeing. When Jesus was asked, "Lord, where is heaven?" he replied, "It is spread before you, only you do not see it." Today we're going to explore how we might see ourselves more clearly, not as separate, you and me, but as one with the rest of life, through the eyes of Vedanta as perceived by a Westerner, our guest, who hails from France, Jean Klein. Jean is a musicologist and doctor who years ago journeyed to India and returned with a new perspective on life. He's the author of several books, including Neither This Nor That I Am and The Ease of Being. Join us for the next hour as we explore the nature of being with Jean Klein. My name is Michael Toms. I'll be your host. Welcome to New Dimensions. John, welcome. What took you to India so many years ago? Why did you go?
I went to India 30 years ago. I had not special perspective, but it was a kind of foreseeing to become serious, I would say. I had a foreseeing of reality in a certain way. Consciously or unconsciously, I was thinking, finding it there.
What did you find? What did you find when you went to India?
I went to the Sanskrit college in Bangalore and South, and informed myself about to make some study, Indology or Sanskrit, and met the Sanskrit teacher, and he was also the boss of the Sanskrit college. So several months after I found this man, I have chosen him as my teacher.
So what happened then? You spent a few years with him?
I spent several years with him, yes. Mm-hmm.
What were you doing in that time with him?
I went every day mainly to him. He was talking about the scriptures.
These were Hindu scriptures?
Yes. I was talking to him about my reactions, my feeling. And he told me mainly to become more and more aware of my surroundings and also mainly aware of my inner surroundings. So very soon I have had a kind of distance, feeling of distance, being more or less spectator or witness to myself and to the surroundings.
So the observer in you was becoming more prominent.
Yes. But he pointed out especially a way of observing without judging and comparison. A pure, choiceless observation, I would say.
What is it that would be making that choiceless observation?
First, I have been aware that I don't observe, really. That was the first thing. So in the moment when I saw that I don't observe, there was a stop. And in this stop, I felt in a certain way presence. I saw that every observation was brought to a kind of center in me, the center of judging and comparison and evaluation, conclusion. In a very short time, my observation has become, I would say, unfurnished. Unfurnished without any expectation. Really, I would say, there was space in this observation. And very soon, I felt myself in this observation. This observation is, of course, not an object. It's not a concept. It is called this observation awareness or consciousness.
You come out of the Western Judeo-Christian tradition just as I do. And there's a great deal of emphasis on the individual in that tradition and the importance of the individual. What happens to the individual, the identity of I, when this observation or this kind of non-identity being emerges?
I found in this observation, I would say, my home ground. In this observation, there was no place for a representation to be a person, to be somebody, to be an individual entity. And
so there was a feeling of connectedness to a whole, so that there was no need to feel the individual identity? But would that be a way of describing it?
In this listening and this attention, it is an intention without borders, without center. The upcoming from an object, the upcoming of the coming up of situations. But when the situation is over, still I felt myself in this presence. And in this presence, in this observation, there's simply no place for to be a person. So the person in his choice, in his desires, has no more any role to play.
So what happens to one's daily life when there's no more role to play? What takes place? What happens?
All the old patterns, as I said, have no more role to play. And every moment was fresh and new. I faced every moment in welcoming. I faced every moment in complete openness. Things becoming more and more richer around me. But I have not been more identified with things around me. I felt things in me, but I have not been in them. That is important.
John, I mentioned in the introduction I used the analogy to drug use as the way we kind of dull our consciousness and dull our awareness, and really with almost with the intention of trying to heighten it, but yet it depresses us. And part of the reason, I think, for that is the immense fear that arises, particularly when one observes the world around oneself and sees it as an us and them dichotomy and sees all the splits and all of the goods and bads and betters and worses. And one can get depressed easily, and so one looks for ways to escape that depression. What about fear? What about fear and the process that you've been talking about of becoming more aware and moving out of our individual identities? What happens to fear in that process?
Fear belongs to somebody. The moment you live, I would say knowingly, in this openness, as I said, then nobody has no place. And as there's no place for nobody, there's no fear. There's no anxiety. But let us say, if you feel fear, anxiety, I would say first free yourself from the concept fear. Because the concept fear is some other fear than the real actual fear. So the concept fear is memory. The moment you fear, free yourself from the concept memory, there's only the perception fear that you feel in your body.
How do you free yourself of the concept of memory? I mean, it seems like a natural part of our brains, of our minds.
It is true, but you can never have simultaneously a concept of fear and feeling fear. Both doesn't go together. So when you come back really to the feeling fear, that is really body feeling, then there's not a concept. Then you face really there's a fact of fear. And then you will see, when you observe fear, that you don't observe it. You try to escape from it. You try to modify it. You interpret it. You justify it. So you must learn in a certain way, observe fear in yourself. And as fear is a condensed energy, it is a reaction, in other words. The moment you observe it in this absolutely without intention, then there's not more an accomplice to the fear, and the energy unfolds. And I would say unfolds in the total energy in you and points directly to your awareness, points directly to your opening, your openness.
I'm speaking with John Klein, author of The Ease of Being, Vedanta teacher from France. We're going to continue. John, you've mentioned the word pattern a few times, and it occurs to me that most of us have a lot of patterns, conditioned mindsets, ways that we perceive what goes on around us, the tendency to perceive things in certain ways. And what? How do we transform those patterns that have been in there for life? I mean, literally recorded tapes that continue to replay and replay and replay themselves. What happens to those patterns?
As long as you take yourself for an entity personnel, then this pattern is necessary because it belongs to your psychological memory. It belongs to your psychological survival. But the moment the reflex of being somebody is going away, also the psychological memory, this pattern goes away too, because they're no more used. So every moment you inquire, you observe, and I would say it, you don't use anymore these patterns. Your brain's functioning in a new way. You become more and more alert. It's like a jacket which you don't use anymore. It loses its quality to be a jacket.
I mean, people in the United States spend years in psychotherapy trying to transform these patterns, or if not transform them, at least understand them a little more clearly. And you're suggesting that in a moment, one can dissolve these patterns. Mm. Is that what you're suggesting, that it is possible to do that with a change of perception?
Therapist believes that there is a personal entity, that there is a person. So through therapy you can become a better person, I would say, a more harmonious person, but still you live in the notion to be a person. And as long as there is a person, there is anxiety, there is fear. Because the person itself is insecurity. The person is constantly creation patterns, systems for security. at the moment you don't take yourself for a person. It means you live in your wholeness, in your completeness, in your emptiness. Then you don't use anymore. There may be a kind of physiological reflex. I agree. But don't you become aware too? You look to it. So I would say, before you understand really what you are, you must first come to the understanding what you are not. Your body, senses and mind, and the pattern. You must be aware how you function from moment to moment, your reactions, your resistance. It is very important.
But we need to understand that we are not, I am not my patterns.
Yes.
I'm something other than my patterns.
Yes.
That the patterns relate to a particular personality which has a very short life.
Yes. But the real life begins when you be established really in life. What we generally call life are the expressions of life, are existence. But it has not, it is not to identify ourselves with our expressions. It is important that we be the life. And from there comes a kind of harmonization. There comes a kind of transformation, transmutation, I would say. Only then there is transmutation. From the level of the I, from the level of the personality, you can never transform. You can change. You can take one object to another place. That is possible. That is, but what we call transmutation, transformation, is not possible. The mind can never change the mind.
Say that again?
The mind can never change the mind.
The mind can never change the mind.
No.
So the mind stays the same, essentially.
Yes. So the transformation factor in us is consciousness, is this awareness. It would say openings. It is completely a feeling of space. Emptiness. Emptiness, it means empty from any representation. To be this or be that. It's very interesting. Try only one morning to be nothing. Which is very comfortable. And you're no weight. There's no heaviness. Only be open. Open, but all that comes to you is more or less a gift. There's no more reaction, no more resistance to it, no more interpretation.
So it's a state of no mind, essentially.
Yes.
It's what the Zen might call no mind.
Yes, yes. Mind in my teaching is more or less a function. Mind is a function.
And you touched on that just as we're not our patterns, we're also not our bodies. So why are we human? Why are we here in bodies on this earth? Doesn't make a lot of sense if we're not our bodies.
Yes. The problem is, now we really our body. What we call our body is more or less a pattern. More, a brain representation. Nothing else. So, when we come to listen to our body, there's no more a projection of a body. When we listen to the body, we come first listening to the superficial system, I would say. But we're coming deeper and deeper and deeper to the energy body, and we will see that our body has something completely different. There's no heaviness in our body. There's I would say there's a kind of feeling of transparency. It's important that we first say, I am not the body. That is true, we are not the body. But before saying I am not the body, we must first say, what is the body, what I am not? So you must explore in a certain way your body, your tension.
So it's not a matter of discounting the body. We need to understand it in order to discard it,
yes,
in a sense.
Yes. And the body are the five senses, and the five senses are the body. Our body is more, it's not a concept. Our body is a perception, it's a feeling. We feel our body. So it is a quality of feeling, I would say.
What about pain? That's a feeling that comes through our bodies.
We come back, the concept of pain is not pain. Sugar is not sweet. You see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So in a certain way we must free ourselves from the concept of pain. Then pain is only a perception. You feel your pain, localized in your lumbar region or your shoulder blades or your certain parts of your body. So you must, in a certain way, pay attention to your perception. And when you pay attention to your perception, there's no more complicity with this perception. And as I said, it's a fixed energy. This energy frees itself and points in a certain way to your observation, to your choiceless observation here. Non-intentional observation. I would say our natural being.
Jean, in your work with the body and in your seminars, you have a special training around the body. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Mm-hmm.
What that involves?
In this approach to our body, I do body movements and body postures which comes very near to the asanas, which is done in the yoga system. And I emphasize mainly the energy body. I work very much the energy body, which brings a kind of transformation in the physical body. One becomes more and more aware of the body. One explores the body in many positions, postures. But, of course, I emphasize in a certain way the body, but it is mainly the presence, the awareness, the openness, which is important in this body approach. Become aware of it. Be aware of oneself. Because in this body approach, you must first accept your body. You must accept the perception. It is a scientific approach. You accept in view. It is not a psychological acceptance. It is a functional acceptance to understand what your body is and your reactions and your contraction and your feeling heavy and so on. So you explore the body, but you can only explore it the moment you accept it totally. It is not so easy for many people to accept themselves, not only as a body, but also in the psychological structure. So in absolute acceptance, in functional acceptance, you become free from what you accept.
Is that acceptance the same as forgiveness?
I would say there's nothing to forgive. In a certain way, you welcome all. All what appears in you, you welcome it. And you give it in a certain way. I would say there's only giving. Yes, giving. And giving comes really out of thinking. Thinking, offering. When you live really in this deep awareness, in being understanding, in other words, there is a feeling of giving, a feeling of offering, a feeling of thinking, I would say. Like a bigger, great artist is a feeling of thinking, of offering. Nobody is there to offer. That is, it's the love of offering, love of giving. So there is no reactions. There are actions which comes out of the moment itself, but these actions are not reactions. Their actions are really giving.
In accepting oneself, I'm just wondering, there's a tendency to want to hold on to certain parts of ourself. It may be pain. We may want to hold on to our pain. It may be a particular way of perception. We may want to hold on to it because it makes us comfortable. What about that in relation to accepting oneself? The tendency to want to attach oneself to a certain way.
It is, you must come to the understanding that only in accepting it that you are one with the healing factor. You are one with the healing factor when you accept it. When you don't accept it, you are against all healing. So the moment you accept yourself, then the body, in a certain way, takes itself in charge. Because the origin of the body is health. The body comes out of health. And the cell knows health. So the moment you accept the body, it takes itself in charge. The doctor is only there to be friend with the body. So there's there's no violence. The moment you don't accept your body, I would say in a certain way you are violent.
Is accepting the same as loving?
Yes, you are right. You are right. Accepting is loving. Yes, absolutely. This accepting, this loving is our wholeness, our completeness. The personality can never love. The personality can never accept. Because the personality is a fraction. Because we speak of love, it would be very interesting to think what we understand by communication. We can never communicate on the personal level. On the personal level, there's only asking, only demanding. In personal relationship, there's only object-object relationship. That means there's only asking and demanding, because the personality is in constant insecurity, looks for recognition, appreciation, and so on. So when the personality has no more any role to play, there's only love, I would say. In real love, there is communication. The personality appears in the love. But we don't identify ourselves with the personality. The personality appears in certain occasions, in certain circumstances. But when the circumstance is over, the personality is over too. That is more and less a real lively personality. It's a cosmic-like personality. What we call our personality is nothing else than memory. Memory for survival for the person. But that goes away. Functional memory remains, but psychological memory goes away.
So in a very real sense, we have to move outside of ourselves in order to really move into a place of loving. We have to let go of that sense of who we are, who we think we are. Is that right?
Yes.
That real love is not possible without doing that.
No. Real love is... I would say you can't even not speak of love. Then you objectify it. Love and joy and peace, you can never objectify it. We see really the mind is helpless. The mind can never pronounce what love and peace and joy is. So I think that it comes when we see giving up of the personality, which is not an intentional giving up. It gives up itself. I think then will be a completely new relation between human beings. And you feel it, you feel it. It is astonishing. In the States, especially in certain parts in California, I met people which are completely open. No conditioned from any becoming, from really open. And then you feel in this openness, you feel yourself free and they are free. That's important. Otherwise, you project only pattern. And you see, I know this person or I know this situation. You know only your projection. It comes to repetition. In repetition, pattern are repetition. There is no relation, real relation, lively relation possible. Your surroundings are more or less furniture. You can contact only a furniture. The moment you see things from the point of view which is not a point of view of love, you can only see love.
Jean, someone who may be listening to this program, and lots of people maybe, in fact, me even, listening to you talk, say someone wants to, that sounds like a good idea, what he's talking about. Mm. What do you do? How do you go about, what say are some first steps? How would one start to move in the direction that you're pointing?
I would say mainly don't try to change your life. Don't try to change anything. Because this entity which likes to change life belongs to life. So don't try to change your life. But I would say become more aware of your surroundings and of your nearer surroundings. Aware means here not to refer your surroundings to a center in you. The center is the I, the me, which looks for security, for pleasure, avoiding pain. See things from your wholeness, from your completeness. In other language, I would say from an impersonal point of view. Then you will see that things around you are completely different. they are coming more richer, because there doesn't belong anymore to a center, but to your completeness, to your totality. In this totality, things are completely different as when you see them from the personal point of view. That is the first thing. You will see that your surroundings, your neighbor, your wife, your husband, your children, are something completely different, appearing completely different to you. And as you are completely open to them, you make them free. You can only make somebody free around you when you are free, when you contact them free from all pattern, free from all clichés. So the first thing is, I would say, try, see that you, what you call your surroundings, is more or less your own resistance, your own reactions. When you see in your life, you meet somebody, and you go away from them and you feel very happy. You said, this person is very a beautiful person. And question yourself, which makes you say that is a beautiful person. It is mainly because the person has given you freedom, completely freedom. Has not superimposed on you a cliché, superimposed on you a schema. You have the possibility to speak free and to be free, if we can speak of a step.
I've been referring to you as a Vedanta teacher, and actually what you teach is a portion of Vedanta, the Advaita, the non-dualistic view, and perhaps you can talk a little bit about the importance of the non-dualistic view as related to what you've already been talking about, the process and the attainment of choiceless awareness. Because here in the West, we're very used to the dualistic view of life.
Yes.
The us and them quality.
What we call generally joy or peace or love is more or less objectified. It's a state, I would say. A state, you go in a state and you go out of a state. When we speak of love and peace and joy here, it is being joy, is being love. It is completely free from all subject-object relationship. There's nobody in love and nobody in peace. That is peace. Look, the world, our surroundings appears according to our point of view. When you look at the world from body senses point of view, the world is nothing else than sensation. And when you look at from the so-called personality, from the media, the world is more or less conception, psychic appearances. But you, when you look at from the point of view, which is not a point of view, of your totality of consciousness, the world is only consciousness. So the expressions we to see in life are expressions of consciousness. your body, senses, and mind is nothing else than an expression of consciousness. You are not the body and senses and mind. But before to say, I am not the senses and the mind, you must first understand what is what you are not. When you come to the understanding what you are not, what remains is really what you are. And then when you come back to say, I am not the senses and mind, then it is not more. Then you feel it as an extension, an expression, a prolongation of yourself. So in this experience, which was without an experiencer, I would say nothing is outside of you. All is in you. It is like in this Zen example, you look at the mountain and you see there the mountain. But when you understand the mountain because you are observer, when you learned the observing, and when you become more and more quiet, that what we call a servant, you will find yourself in the observing position. And there's a moment, there's nothing to observe, but you are still observing. So you're completely in your observing, completely autonomous. And then you come back to the mountains, and you will see of course they are the mountains, but they are more or less an expression of yourself. You give a name and you perform to it, but it is more or less an expression of yourself. So there's nothing outside of yourself, all is inside yourself. All appears in your awareness, in your presence. But nobody is present. Nobody is present. There's only presence. Nobody is aware of anything. There's no duality.
Why would that not be a state of like entropy or inertia, of non-movement, not going anywhere, just sort of status quo, staying still?
In other words, would you call me another way?
What you're saying, why is that not a state of inertia, a state of non-movement, a state of not doing anything, not progressing, not regressing, not going anywhere,
yes, yes.
Not doing anything,
yes.
Not being anyone? And maybe it is all those things. I don't know.
The moment you live in your fullness, in your real nature, all situations, all surroundings refers to your real nature. And in this moment, you are completely appropriate to every moment. Because every situation brings its solution. You can never find a solution in a situation. It is completely arbitrary, the solution. Real solution is in the situation. So every situation belongs to you. Every situation brings a solution and is right acting. Right acting, right doing, right thinking comes only when you are open to it, aware to it.
John, thank you very much for being with us today. It's been a pleasure talking with you.
Thank you, too.
I've been speaking with John Klein, author of Neither This Nor That I Am, and a book entitled The Ease of Being.